Today, the scripture reading is from the book of Philippians, chapter 2, and verses 5 through 11. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. That is the name of Jesus. Every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. That needs an amen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight this day, and indeed every day. Amen. Got a video clip to show you, see if any of you might recognize this. Any of you recognize that? Jesus Christ Superstar. Showing right now up at Broadway Palms, I think, the dinner theater. You know, when you watch that, of course, that's done in modern times. But the message it's trying to portray is fundamentally the same. Jesus was coming into Jerusalem, and here he comes. He's going to change the whole world. And they are all excited. They're waving their palms. They're all just really fired up. Things are going to be grand, and he's going to come in, and he's going to show them one thing or another. Did you catch in that clip in that particular show? At one point they say, Jesus, won't you fight for me? Did you catch the look on the actor's face? He kind of gets this look of, whoa, 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 whoa. You don't get it. And then at the very end, they say, won't you die for me? Well, in the scriptures, they don't know that part yet. That's yet to come. But the fact of the matter is, this Christ has entered into town, and he is going to be the Messiah. Now, the Messiah had two components to him. You had the one component that is the Davidic king, if you will. He's going to be the replacement of the king of David, going to take over the rule of the country, and all's going to be well. And the other half of the Messiah was someone who was going to be the high priest. So he presented a direct and immediate threat to the Roman government and a direct and immediate threat to Caiaphas and Ananias and all of these people who were in a leadership position within the temple. So they're not really, really happy with this, are they? Which was portrayed actually fairly well as those priests. They're quite upset with things. That is real. And this Palm Sunday, Jesus enters. But yet notice, what does he enter on? A donkey or a colt. He does not enter on a white steed. Now somebody at the 930 service pointed out, well, in battle, the king would always ride a donkey so nobody knew that it was the king. What I didn't say to him was, if the king always rode a donkey into battle, they would quickly know, kill who's ever on the donkey. The donkey was a symbol of humbleness. That's what it was all about. And it's to this which the Apostle Paul writes. Paul isn't directly addressing Philippians or Palm Sunday to the church at Philippi, but yet he is. And that's why it's the lectionary passage for today. You see, Paul writes to the church, and what is he saying to them? First and foremost, Jesus Christ was fully God. He had everything. There was no coronation ceremony to make him king because he's already God. He's already got everything. But what does Jesus, fully God, do? He humbles himself by becoming a human being, lives amongst us, walks, eats, breathes, and subsequently dies. He becomes humble around us. By the way, does humble mean weak? Some of the most humble people you will ever meet prove to be the strongest. And some of the proudest prove to be the weakest. So he's going to be humble as he's coming to this earth. But he subsequently, in his humbleness, even turns himself over on Good Friday to die. And when he dies, he then shows his greatest strength of all. Because in order to be resurrected from the dead, he first had to die. And being humble, the most humblest point he could make by dying on a cross, God then exalts him. And then how does Paul end it? So that everybody will know that every knee shall bow and tongue confess Christ Jesus as Lord and Savior. What does this all mean, though? First and foremost, this person we call Jesus is fully God. He had everything. Go back and look at John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. God, fully God. If you don't believe me, go back and read Genesis. Let us make man in our image. Jesus is there in the very beginning. He's fully God. How much power does Jesus have? All of it. He's got it all. Think of the Gospel of John. What is the first miracle in the Gospel of John? Turns the water into wine. By the way, not the cheap stuff. He turns it into the good stuff. You know the top shelf where you got to dust it off? You don't get to it too often? He turns it into the good stuff. And then you build beyond that. There are the stormy seas. One point, he just falls asleep on it. They're all afraid they're going to drown. They wake him up, and what's he do? Calms the sea. Oh, He heals the sick, thinks nothing of it. He even heals people that were born blind. He then will go on to raise people from the dead, not just one, but several. If that ain't God, I don't know what is. He has the power. Remember Lazarus? He was dead 3 days, and he brought him back to life. And then Christ shows the ultimate power. He dies on Good Friday and comes back to life on Easter morning. He is fully God. But what does Jesus choose to do? Kind of abdicates the throne. Well, not completely, but he gives it up and humbles himself to become a servant up to the point that he dies on a cross. You see, he humbles himself completely, and in humbling himself, emptying himself completely, giving everything he possibly has, it's at that point and that point alone that he's able to beat death. That's the point where Easter is now able to occur. Jesus teaches us consistently that things are upside down from what the world teaches us. You know, if you want to be powerful, you got to have money. You have to have a lot of people working for you. You have to have great influence. You have to have all those things. That's what the world teaches. Well, what does Christ teach? Something very different. Did any of you ever read Lewis Carroll's Through the Looking Glass? You know, it's Alice in Wonderland. Well, first of all, I want to know what Carroll was drinking when he wrote that, because it's a little weird in there. Maybe he was doing something else. I don't know. But this much I do know. Alice comes to this mirror, goes through the mirror, finds herself in this strange place. And what she discovers is, when she tries to walk forward, she ends up in walking backwards. When she turns to her left, she ends up in going to her right. When she runs, she ends up in going slower and slower and slower and slower and slower. When she walks really, 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 really slow, she finds herself running. Everything is the opposite of what her world told her was reality. Jesus pretty much has done the same thing. Think about it. If you want to be loved, what do you first need to do? Love others. By the way, if you want to have a friend, what do you first need to do? Be a friend. It's really simple. Keep going. If you want to be first in the kingdom, be the last. If you want to be the leader of many, become the servant of all. It is the opposite of everything. If you want to live forever, you must die. You must die to this world. Everything is a complete opposite, and that's what Christ is teaching. He gave up everything, and in giving up everything, he gained. It's even interesting if you look at ourselves or somebody else that you know of, that any time they've gone through depression. And what's it feel like when you're depressed? You just want to go into a corner. You want to pull away from everything. Maybe not get out of bed or stay in your little house or your little cubbyhole. And as the depression worsens, you tend to disconnect from others. But what happens? What happens if you're able to step out of the cycle and you go down to the will say to the, come here to the food pantry on Monday and start volunteering. What happens when you start volunteering? You begin to feel better. What happens when you start to give things that are of importance to you away, particularly of your time? You start to feel better. You see, the folks that fight with depression, if they can learn the trick, the more you give of yourself, the more you will be lifted up. And it's also an odd conundrum within the church. Oftentimes when folks first become deacons and they have to go visit somebody, they will talk about how difficult it is. Oh, what am I going to say? Oh, this is going to be hard. How can I go visit somebody I don't know and then sit there for 5, 10, 15 minutes or go to the hospital? And I try to tell them, when you go visit somebody, visit a shut-in who hasn't seen anybody in 3 months, how are they? First of all, you don't have to talk. because they have had so many words stored up, they can't ready to get, just can't wait to blurt them out. And they'll sit there and talk away. We had one little old woman. This is a bonus feature, wasn't in the other services. Mildred Winters. She died at 102. We'd go to visit her, and oh my heavens, you just sat down. You didn't have to say a word for 30 minutes. Mildred, oh, I remember when my brother went off to the Spanish-American War. My mother was so mad at him. You know, of course, that she was the second president of the Women's Christian Temperance Union. Carrie Nation was her good friend. And she would just go on and tell you all the, oh, I know, it's just amazing. And you walked away, and suddenly you felt better. Because you see, when you give of yourself, when you love others, somehow you get something in return. Now, you don't do it to get something in return. You do it to just give. And that's what Christ is talking about. He completely emptied himself so that he would then be exalted and become king. And what occurs? He ends up and dying, comes back to life on Easter. And at that point, he brings people to know the Father better. And what does God the Father do? Paul says is at that point, when Jesus is exalted to the point that every knee shall bow and tongue confess Christ as Lord and Savior. It's about saving the world, not condemning it. How many of us as Christians have had people talk to us or about us, not necessarily us, but us as a group, Christians, and say, we are judgmental. We are negative. You're always questioning, are you going to hell? Do you know where you're going when you die? This sin will lead you there, da-da-da-da. They go down these lists of all kinds of things they say about us because they somehow think that. And that can be challenging. But what does Christ teach us to do as Christians? Throughout Scripture, he tells us to be humble. How are we humble? Sometimes by just being generous. And it's generous not just with our money, but with our time and talent, right? How many times are we to forgive others? Not seven times, but 70 times seven. That doesn't seem judgmental to me. Keep going down the list. Blessed are the peacemakers. Could we use some peacemakers in the world today? Especially after the events of last week and even this morning. And he even says, take up your cross and follow me. It's about being humble. There's even a passage that talks about praying for your enemies. Did you follow the events of last week? The events where in Syria, some airplanes went and bombed a town and used apparently sarin gas. Bunch of little children, as well as adults, lost their lives by a gas that is prohibited by the Geneva Convention. Horrible. Our response, which I do think was limited, attacked that Air Force base where it was launched from. But yet, the problem remains. There was a crisis that occurred this morning. Anybody see the news this morning? I mean, it breaks my heart. Two of the Coptic Christian churches in Egypt were attacked. Bombs went off. Dozens of people were killed. Many more were injured. Holly, Joyce, and I and some others were in one of those churches. And I saw your note. We're still hoping George is okay. But the fact of the matter is, there's a lot of hatred going around. But what does Jesus call us to do? He calls us to pray for them. To even pray for our enemies. I remember when Jessica at one point wanted to lead a group here to pray for ISIS about a year and a half back. Oh, did I catch flack? Oh, my heaven. How dare we pray for them? We should bomb them. We should kill them. Look, there's a military component. That's important. I'm not taking that away. But what does Christ call us to do for our enemies? Pray for them. Should we be praying for ISIS? Should we be praying for those that are in leadership of Syria? The answer is yes. Should we be praying for North Korea? Should we be praying for Iran? Might we need to be praying for Russia? Fact is, we need to be praying for all that we hold dear, those who are friends as well as those who are our enemies. We are called to humble ourselves. But in humbling ourselves, it's at that point we become exalted. That in our, well, meekness, we become closer and closer to Christ Jesus himself. So what does it mean? What do we take away from this? First of all, when Jesus came in on that Palm Sunday, he was already king. He was already God. He didn't need to prove anything to anybody. Instead, what does Christ do? He gives up everything to serve us, to the point this coming Friday, Good Friday, we remember his death on a cross. But it took his death on the cross for him to be exalted, for him to be truly seen as the Son of God, and to point everyone to the Lord. Here's the deal. At the end of time, every knee will bow and tongue confess Christ as Lord and Savior. Pastor Carol probably remembers when she went to seminary. After you graduate seminary, you then have to go on to become ordained. So there, you've got your degree behind you, and you take these exams. They have five exams, a Bible content exam, which is trivia pursuit of the Bible. Good luck. We got through it, right? Then there are four other exams that you have to take. They're nothing. The Feast de Resistance is when you go before your presbytery and have what they call the trials of ordination. See, a church offers you a call. That's the final step, per se. But the presbytery will then question you to see if you're ready. I was ordained by Pittsburgh Presbytery, at that time the largest presbytery in the United States, 159 Presbyterian churches in Allegheny County alone. I go to the presbytery meeting, there are 450 pastors and elders there. You got to go stand in front of them all, and you read your statement of faith to them, which is kind of like the Apostles' Creed, but your version of the Apostles' Creed. So I read it to them. And then they said, okay, the floor is now up for questions. They can ask you anything they want. It can be about the Bible. It can be about your studies. By the way, yes, it can be about your personal life. They can ask you anything they want. It's all up for grabs. You're out in the open. Talk about being nervous. So a guy gets up, walks up to the mic, says, Clint, in your statement of faith, you talk about every knee shall bow and tongue confess Christ is Lord. You also go on to state that anyone who has accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior are welcomed into the kingdom of heaven. But Scripture teaches us that even the devil's angels in hell know that Christ is their Lord and Savior. So why aren't they in heaven? And I turned to him and I said, thank you for the easy question. And I wasn't kidding, because it was. You see, sir, with all due respect, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess shall know Christ as Lord and Savior. But there comes a point in time when in everyone's life you must choose to follow Christ or to ignore Christ. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he sent his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. But 17. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Everyone has an opportunity to accept Christ, but there comes a point where that opportunity has passed. Death. Maybe another reason. There comes a point. The angels in hell, as well as others who are in Gehenna, will know that Jesus is the Christ. And every knee shall bow and tongue confess Christ as Lord and Savior. But for them, it's too late. The question is, for you and me, have we made the proper decision And are we ready now? Don't wait. Did that answer your question? No one asked any more questions. And they ordained this scoundrel. But here's the thing. Christ didn't come into the world to condemn the world. We as Christians are not called to go out and be judgmental and condemning of others. Rather, we are to humble ourselves just like Christ, to love and to serve those who are around us, so that our very lives may point to God the Father, just as Christ pointed to God the Father. So that, like on Easter Day when the resurrection occurred, people can see the resurrection of Christ in us. And maybe, just maybe, because of us, every knee may bow and tongue confess Christ as Lord and Savior. And may they do it in a timely manner and not wait until it's too late. Thanks be to God. Our hymn is hymn number 277, My Savior's Love. For those who are able, I invite you to stand and join in.